We made this game called Space Rocks in a tutorial before, and now we're going to add gamepad support to it. Right now we can move the ship with the arrow keys and shoot with the left mouse button. With a gamepad, we're gonna be able to turn the ship with the left analog stick, accelerate with the right trigger so you can control how much you want to accelerate, and shoot with a face button. This video is only gonna cover GML code, so if you've been using GML Visual so far, then this might be a good chance for you to experience coding in GameMaker for the first time. I'm gonna open my project, and first of all, I'm gonna make a new script asset and call this gamepad_vars. I'm gonna use this to set up some global variables for the input system. You're gonna see the script has a function defined in it, but I'll remove that because we only want to make some variables here. We don't want any functions. So first of all, I'll define an empty array called gamepads. So you know how a variable can store a single value? Now imagine if that variable was able to store multiple values inside it, like a list, and you were able to access each value in the list using its position in the list, like 0, 1, 2, and so on. That's basically what an array is. It's a list of values, and you access values from it by their position, which starts at 0. So we're gonna use this array to store all the gamepads that are connected to the system. For this game, we are only going to use the first gamepad that's connected because this is a single player game. But in the future, if you want to support multiple players or switching between multiple gamepads, then having an array of all the gamepads that are connected is useful. Next in the script, I'm going to make a variable to store the main gamepad that will be used for gameplay. I'll set it to undefined right now because we haven't detected any gamepads at this point. Now let's go and make an object and call this obj_input. The role of this object is going to be to detect any gamepads connecting to the system and add them to the array that we made. And it's also going to detect gamepads being removed from the system, so it can then remove them from the array as well. Make sure you do first go into your room and put an instance of this object in there so it actually runs its code. Then let's go back into the object and add a new event here. Under asynchronous, call the async system event. Whenever a gamepad is connected to the system or it's disconnected, then the async system event is gonna run and it's gonna give us info about that gamepad in a map called async load. So this is a map data structure, and you don't need to worry about how to use a map if you've never used it before. The only thing you need to know is how to get a value out of a map, which is using this syntax. So this is the name of the map, and this is the value that you want to get out of it. So in the event, first of all, we're going to get the index of the gamepad out of the map and store it in a local variable. Then we're going to run a switch statement on the type of event that was fired, which can be either gamepad discovered or gamepad lost. So in the case of gamepad discovered, we want to take the gamepad and add it to our array. So for that, I'm going to use the array push function to add it to the global gamepads array, and the value that I'm adding is simply the gamepad index that I previously stored in the local variable. And right now we're also gonna take the opportunity to set the dead zone of the controller to 20% so that any analog stick inputs below 20% are not going to register. Now in the case of gamepad lost, we want to remove the gamepad from the array if it is in there. So I'll use the array getIndex function to find the position of the gamepad in the gamepads array. This will return the position of the gamepad in the array if it is found and store it in this local variable. So if it is found, it's gonna be 0 or higher, and we are checking for that in this condition here. And when that is true, we are deleting that position from the array so that the gamepad is removed. Now at the end of the event, regardless of whether a gamepad was added or removed, we want to set the main gamepad to the first gamepad in the array. So first of all, we want to make sure that the array has at least one gamepad. And after that, we're gonna set the main gamepad to the first one in the array. But if the array happens to be empty, then we set the main gamepad back to undefined. So our gamepad detection system is now set up. The main gamepad variable is gonna store a gamepad if it's connected, otherwise it's gonna be undefined. So in our player object, we simply check if it's not undefined, and then we read input from it. So let's go into the obj player object and open the step event. Here we're gonna need to make some modifications because it's already set up for keyboard input, but it's not quite right for gamepads. So let's set up local variables for these at the top. And initially, these are gonna store keyboard input, and then we're gonna read gamepad input. So the first variable will be for acceleration, which will be the hold state of the up arrow key. Then the turn input, which will be the hold state of the right arrow key minus the left arrow key. So for right, this will give us 1, and for left, it will give us minus 1. Then for firing, it's gonna detect a press of the left mouse button. These variables are now set up the way we need them, but we're not detecting gamepad input yet, so let's do that. I'll take the main gamepad value into a local variable that's quicker to write, and then make sure it's not undefined, so a gamepad is connected. Then I'll set the acceleration input to a button on the gamepad, which will be gp_shoulder_rb. This is the right trigger. Next, the turn input will be an axis on the gamepad, which will be gp_axis_lh, which is the left stick's horizontal axis. Finally, the fire input will be the press of a button on the gamepad, which will be gp_face1. So all of these buttons and axes are documented in the manual on the gamepad input page. So I'll link that in the description so you can read all about the buttons and axes that you have access to and all the functions that you can use with them. So now that we are reading gamepad input, let's make our movement work with these variables. So I'll make the acceleration dependent on the move variable and make the 0.1 acceleration value multiply with the move input so it changes depending on how far you have the trigger pressed. Then I'll remove the condition for turning left and just make it work in one block. This condition here will check if the turn input is not 0, and in that case it will subtract 4 from the image angle, but only after multiplying that with the turn input. So again, even the turning will be dependent on how much you're moving the left stick. And then at the end, we also need to change the fire condition to use the new local variable. By the way, I made a mistake here. So the function call I used to get the trigger value for acceleration needs to be gamepad button value and not gamepad button check. See, the check function just returns true or false, so it's on or off movement, but gamepad button value will get you the trigger state from 0 to 1, so you can move slower or faster. And that was the whole reason why we are multiplying it with the acceleration value later on. So we're gonna make sure to use gamepad button value here. And with this, your game should now work with a gamepad. So run it and you should be able to control it with all the inputs that you've programmed. Now you will notice that if you try to play with your keyboard while your gamepad is connected, the keyboard is not gonna work. This is because in our code, we are replacing the input values when a gamepad is connected. So whatever input we had from the keyboard is not used at all. So to allow input from both the keyboard and the gamepad, instead of replacing the values here, you can add to them using the plus sign, because they are numbers after all. Just make sure that you clamp the values to their maximum ranges after reading all the input, because you don't want the player to be able to go faster by pressing accelerate on their keyboard and gamepad at the same time, so they add up and become 1 plus 1 equals 2. And with this change, you should be able to control the player with the arrow keys and the gamepad as well. A more sophisticated system might just read input from one device at a time and would be able to switch between the devices based on where it's reading inputs, but this is a quick and easy solution. I recommend playing around with the gamepad functions. Just read the manual, try different things, and make sure to have fun. Finally, if you're making a game for consoles, they have their own requirements for how gamepads should be detected, and they have their own functions for finding gamepads and connecting user accounts to gamepads, so make sure you read the documentation for whatever console you're making your game for. And I'll end this here. If you want tutorials on anything specific, let me know in the comments. And remember, keep trying, keep failing, and keep learning. That's the only way up. Bye.